Compression is a trade-off between space used, bandwidth, and additional computational resources for compression and decompression. Most of the data can be represented visually as a table, but from a storage perspective, we have few ways to represent that table. In row-wise storage, data is stored and organized based on rows, and it's a great format when accessing all the columns of a row is a common operation. But when you have to select a single column and maybe do aggregation, you end up loading and parsing a lot of data that you are not interested in. So in column-wide storage, data is stored and organized based on columns, which enables efficient compression and encoding techniques that exploit the data type characteristic and the data similarities within the columns. Hybrid storage combines elements of both row-wise and column-wise storage methods. So in a row-wise storage and traditional formats like JSON or CSV, we can apply generic compression algorithms, since we have different kind of data. Those algorithms are great and exploit redundancy and patterns within the data to eliminate unnecessary information, resulting in a more compact representation. But if we focus on a single column with a specific data type and maybe even a specific pattern, we can apply a specific set of rules to compress the data in a more efficient way. Let's start from the basics with integers. If you use C or Java, you may be familiar with short, int, and long, respectively being 2, 4, and 8 bytes. With some shifting and masking, we can encode values using only the necessary bytes, and this is a fundamental concept for reducing the data size. Typically, if we have a sequence of int, for each value we can just write on disk the 4 bytes. But for small numbers, we are wasting a lot of space. So what we can do is to compute the required number of bytes for the value, write that number, followed by the value, written using just the required number of bytes. If the numbers are always small, we save a lot of space, but we are also wasting 1 byte per entry to encode a length that is between 1 and 8. And that's one area where we can do better. If we know that our maximum value can be represented with 4 bytes, we can use 2-bit to store the length. But since we have to write at least 1 byte, we can pack into a single byte 4 values of 2-bit. In this way, we have reduced the overhead, and we only have 1 extra byte every 4 values. Similarly, if our sequence contains values that require 64-bit, we can use 3-bit to store the length and pack into 3 bytes 8 values of 3-bit. In this case, the overhead is 3 bytes every 8 values. If the sequence has values that are more or less around the same bit width, we can use simple 8B encoding. This encoding scheme uses 8 bytes, with the first 4 bit used for the selector, which describes what will follow, and 60 bit that can pack one or more values. The maximum value that we can store with this scheme is 60 bit long. If the selector is 0, then it means that we have 240 numbers with value 0, the 60 bit are unused. If the selector is 1, then it means that we have 120 numbers with value 0, again the 60-bit are unused. If the selector is 2, then it means that we can write 60 values of 1 bit. If the selector is 3, then it means that we can write 30 values of 2 bit, and so on. Up to now, we have just encoded numbers as they are, but using less bits. Let's try to leverage some simple math. By computing the difference between values, we may be able to save few bytes. And if we have something like time series, where every interval you collect a value, like temperature, memory usage, counter, and so on, these values most of the time are similar one to another, so the delta will be a smaller number. This will typically result in sequences with a lot of repetitions. If our series has a lot of repetition, we can apply run length encoding, which means that we prefix the value by the number of repetition. If the storage support pushdown predicate, encoding like this also allows to compute the result or part of the result without even decompressing the data. As you may imagine, here we have a lot of options to encode the repetition count and value. We can leverage grouping, do bit packing, and so on. Bit packing is a technique where you store data using few bits as possible. Here, there are a lot of different encoding schemes. But just to give you an example, you can make a scheme that identifies which type of encoding you are using and then store the information you need. Here are two examples. One where you store a single run length encoded item with the number of repetition and the value. The other where you have a linear sequence and you store the base value, the delta value, and the number of items. Where you have a sequence obtained with delta encoding, so you store the base value and all the delta values with a fixed bit width. And below, just a sequence of fixed bit values. This is just one of many possible ways to do bit packing. One thing to note is that most of the algorithm works best when the data is sorted. If we can use a bit more CPU, we can always sort the items, or at least sort group of items. For an extra 8 bytes, we can store an index with a sort order of 15 items. In this way, we can apply our encoding on the sorted sequence and when returning the values to the user, we can use the index to give them back in the original order. Compressing string or bytes is a bit more complex, since the data tend to be more random, and generic compression algorithms are great at that. But if we know that our data is sorted, we can apply incremental encoding, which means that we can remove the common prefix between strings. Basically, this is the same as delta encoding, but for strings. The result of operation are an array of prefixes and an array with the remaining length, plus the various string without the common prefix. If we have things like enums, or we have a limited set of values that repeat frequently, we can use dictionary encoding. Instead of storing the values directly, dictionary encoding works by making a list of possible values that can appear and storing the index. The result is an array of possible values and an array of indexes. At this point, we can apply run length encoding on the index and incremental encoding on the possible values, if they are strings or bytes. This technique is quite versatile and can be used regardless of the data type, so you can apply it also on numbers. If the storage supports pushdown predicates, we can do check against the dictionary without the need to decompress all the values. Sometimes you need to encode only a single integer. There are a couple of techniques that allow us to do that, using less bytes as possible. A value can be encoded into groups of 7 bits, with a continuation bit. A continuation bit of 1 indicates that the encoding continues onto the next byte. With 1 byte, you can represent a value between 0 and 127, with 2 bytes from 128 and 16384, and so on. If your numbers are small, like string length or sequence length, it's a good way to encode a single value. A different approach is the one used by SQLite 4. The code is a bit more complex and mathematical. If the value is between 0 and 240, it is encoded as a single byte, which is way more than the previous variant encoding scheme. If the value is below 2287, it is encoded with 2 bytes, with some calculation to get byte 1 and byte 2. If the value is below 67823, it's encoded with 3 bytes, where the first byte is fixed at 249, and to get the byte 2 and 3, you have to do some calculation. Above that, you use the first byte as the identifier for how many bytes are following, and those are encoded as big endian. This scheme is great for smaller values, but you also know the number of bytes just by looking at the first byte, and it also preserves the numeric ordering if you compare it with memcompare, so it can be used as a key in a raw key value storage. In all the examples, we haven't talked about big endian and little endian. That's a choice that you can make when encoding your values. Also, we always assume positive values. You can always encode the bit sign, or you can use zigzag encoding to map negative values to positive values and back. You can find these techniques in columnar databases, time series databases, or file formats like Apache Parquet or Apache ORC. I hope that this overview of encoding techniques was useful, and if you want to know more or you have any question, leave a comment below.